I am honored to be able to speak in front of such a nice audience, and I thank the organizers who made it possible for me. Actually, my handwriting is not that nice as Joel's. Also, my English obviously is not comparable. And the subject will not be as interesting as any of the lectures which we heard in the forenoon. The only thing which works for me is that, as you can see, that I have a tie and a coat, which is actually a suffering at that time. Maybe the company is world-class company, but the air conditioning is still not working maybe properly. So after this short, that was the introduction. So after that, I will try to start with the lecture itself. And sorry, really, for the handwriting. I cannot manipulate the computer. And also, I am left-handed, but I was forced to learn to write with my right hand. So it causes me a lot of trouble, believe me, even if I don't give a lecture at the conference. Especially when I drive and I cannot distinguish between left and right. Okay, so the type is little bit misleading on the proof of Pósa Seymour conjecture, because there are proofs. But the main thing is that I would like to show one method which is called the connecting lemma or connecting method, and it in the simplest possible form. But before we go, that actually that will happen only at the end of the talk. So, and this is a joint work with my student Asif Jamshed. Now I will will go through very fast. Can you read it? That in 1974, Paul Seymour conjectured that any graph G on order n and minimum degree at least k minus 1 over k times n contains the k minus 1's power of a Hamiltonian cycle. Later I will define what is a k minus 1's power. The conjecture was proved with the help of the regularity blow-up lemma method by Komlo, Sarközi and myself, but for extremely big n. So here n is large, and then now we present another proof that avoids the use of the regularity lemma, thus the resulting n zero. No, sorry. This I wanted. The resulting n zero previously was pretty big. Right now it is much, much smaller. Actually, most probably for the Pósa conjecture, you can check, it will be so small that hopefully a good programmer can check that the Pósa's conjecture is true for every n, but of course this is not clear yet. And then the new main ingredient is a new kind of connecting lemma or connecting method. These are just the usual notations. Very fast I will go through. G is a graph, VG is the vertex set, EG is the edge set. If and A and B are disjoints, and then E, that is crazy. A and B are disjoint, of course, and this is a bipartite graph, and E, A, B is the set of edges. And then G, restricted U, is just a restriction of the graph on U, and V, usual notation, is the set of the vertices so that XV is an edge, and then if we choose a subset of the vertex set S, then the neighborhood in S is simply the pairs, the edges XV, X is so that XV is an edge, but X is also in S. Delta G is the maximum degree. Unfortunately, I cannot distinguish between this is delta for me and this is delta for me too. And while it's a big delta, let's call it big delta. I am pretty sure there is a correct scientific name for that. Next time I will check it. So it is big delta G is the maximum degree and small delta G is the minimum degree of a graph. And KRT is a balanced complete R-pi-tide graph with color classes of size T. Any question with this so far? I guess it's well known, and DAB is just the density of the graph spanned on A and B. So it's the number of edges between A and B divided by A times B. Actually, B can be A. It doesn't have to be a bipartite graph. The definition is general. On the next page. Okay. And then we say that G is gamma dense if the number of edges is bigger than the gamma percentage of the all possible number of edges, namely, then G is bigger than gamma times n choose 2. And GAB is gamma dense if it contains at least, again, the same thing, gamma times the size of A. The absolute value is always the size of the set. It's not the usual absolute value. It's the cardinality of the set. So if at least gamma times A times B edges we have in our graph. Powers, now here I will explain the powers of cycles. What is K minus 1 powers? The powers of cycles. Let C be a cycle. The case power of C, so this is just a graph. C is a cycle. And the case power of C devoted by CK is defined as follows. This is the notation. Let's see whether I can control this. Yes, VCK, the vertex set is the same cycle, except there is an extra condition, then and UV is an edge in CK if the distance between U and V in C is at most K. Like the square of a Hamiltonian cycle, then there is a cycle, and then the points which are this distance of two from U also are connected to U. Any question with this power? Unfortunately, I shouldn't have had a picture, but everybody, I hope, understand it. Okay, of course, the larger the K, the more structure we have. And then... Sorry? Combinatorial? Oh, the cycle is just a cycle. This is a simple graph. I mean, we order the vertices x1, x2, x3, and so on, and so on, xn, and then the consecutive xi is connected to xi plus 1. Just the usual cycle. No, actually, I claim that I'm not going to talk about anything which is complicated. So very elementary graph theory, nothing more. Yes, sorry for that. Sorry?
Why do you need the adjective Hamiltonian if it's a cycle?
Well, it's a cycle, but eventually we are in where we I can define a cycle, yes? In a usual way, just X, I order vertices, maybe not all of them, x1, x2, and so on, xk, and they form a cycle, and xi is connected to xi plus 1. That is a cycle, the usual thing. And Hamiltonian if all the vertices are in the cycle. Now the square of the Hamiltonian cycle is that every second neighbor also is connected to the vertex. And the third power is every the neighbor, the second neighbor, and the third neighbor is also connected to vertex. So, but the look, if I am not able to write properly, then obviously it's much harder for me to draw the picture. There you will see a picture later, all of you will agree that actually this is an abstract picture which has absolutely no meaning or many interpretation, just like all abstract pictures, right? So unfortunately, I try to avoid the pictures, though I am well aware that if somebody is good enough, then the many graphs result is just better. Is just the sequence of pictures. But unfortunately, I am not able to do this. So therefore, I try to write it down. So any question now then, what is the case power of a Hamiltonian, of a cycle? No, no, not Hamilton, of a cycle. Okay, thank you. And the conjecture in the 60-61, I guess, Pósa, let G be a graph on n vertices if the minimum degree is 2/3. It's not 9, it is 3, 2/3 times 9, then it follows that G contains a square of a Hamiltonian cycle. And a conjecture of Seymour later, then almost the same, but the minimum degree is k minus 1 over k times n, then G contains a k minus 1's power of a Hamiltonian cycle. If k is equal to 3, then we get back Pósa's conjecture. So Seymour's conjecture is a generalization of this actually is tight, one can say that even to have a complete k graphs, actually if you have a k minus 1 power of a Hamiltonian cycle, and let us assume that k divides n, then of course you can break it into complete k's, yes? So, and then the bound for the complete case and covering with disjoint complete case graph is also the same number, k minus 1 over k over n. So this is very interesting, then the number is same. So to get a much more powerful structure, you need the same threshold, namely k minus 1 over k times n. Okay. Now, so I just mentioned, I don't want to mention all the results, just one or two, or arbitrarily I choose two or three, which I mentioned, and then of that type of question, definitely I left out most of the important results. Or I would like lastly mention or type condition, which is the following, which is a generalization of then the every point has a degree 2/3 times n, then let's say that so x and y is not connected. No, that is wrong. No, that is really crazy. Now what I am doing, it's all good. Now I'm here. This I have to, you can see, this is in my right hand, right? So if I changed it, I will try now with my left hand, but I hope then I will not make mistake. Yes, of course, it's much easier. So all time condition is the following. Then if x and y is not connected, but their degree, take the sum of their degree is bigger than 4 over 3 times n, then de Basio, Fazulach and Kahn prove that if the OR type condition holds with 4 over 3 times n, then if n is bigger than n0, then G contains a square of Hamiltonian cycle. This is a generalization of Pósa's theorem. Yes, because in Pósa's theorem, every degree is 2/3 times n, so obviously, every take any two point, if are not connected, the sum 2/3 plus 2/3 is 4/3 times n. So, but actually the proof method is exactly the same as the proof methods for Pósa. Using more exactly, the method is using the new, I actually put it in parentheses because I don't really know whether it's a new or old, I don't know too much the literature, but for sure, honestly, I have never seen that kind of connecting lemma. But actually, it could be the case that I have never read too many papers, so still it's open whether it's new or not. So I call it new just for simplicity. New connecting lemma, they got a reasonably small n0 here. But we got to. Now let's see whether I can use the left hand side. Yes. Now, this everything so far was only for graphs. Now we move for hypergraphs. For k uniform hypergraphs, age, let me check age, yes, by a k cycle of lengths L bigger or equal than k plus 1, we mean a k uniform hypergraph whose vertices can be ordered cyclically. X1, X2, too adventurous I am today. X1, X10, so on XL, so in such a way that for each L, 1, 2, and 3, and so on, for each number, xi, xi plus 1 and xi plus l minus 1 is an edge of the hypergraph. You see, this is a very clumsy picture where k is equal to 3, and then, of course, the intersection of any consecutive 2 is 2 points. If you can see, then it actually is supposed to be 2 points. 1 point, 2 points, yes? So the next, for the path, the definition is the same. You just don't close the whole thing, but up to that, the path exactly has this property, then any two consecutive intersect each other in 2 points. Yes, and for k uniform hypergraphs, if k is not 3, then the intersection of two consecutive edge is k minus 1. Any question with this notion? This is for hypergraph. Please ask questions, because now I am master of this computer, or close to it at least. Now I am now concentrating only on three uniform hypergraph, and then there are some results in three uniform hypergraph, again using the conjecture lemma, and I just mentioned one or two of them. So if V is a vertex, then delta 2 star V is the so is the number of let me see, so it's a it's no I messed it up because here I should have write sorry for a minute, I will check. Okay, I change it so the following thing, that you take an edge, don't read anything here, take an edge, and then just U and W, don't read anything, take an edge, U and W, take a pair, it's much better because edge is the edges of the hypergraph. Take a pair U and W, and then delta 2 UW, it should be not, it should depend on two variables. UW is the set of V, so that UVW is an edge. So take a pair, and you see then how many ways you can extend it so that you will get an edge of the graph. Sorry for that, I didn't notice that. Well, of course, it should depend on edge, because now we are talking about pairs. So on every pairs, some number of points sitting, so that the three of them form an edge of edge. And then with Rudruchinsky, we proved that if it is bigger than 1/2 times n, then edge contains a Hamiltonian cycle. Now, what is a Hamiltonian cycle? For hypergraph, I guess already I defined in the previous page. Then order the vertices, and every three, yes, every consecutive three is an edge of our graph. And the proof is much more difficult than to prove the existence of the Hamiltonian cycle under the condition you see, almost the same condition, except we added an epsilon here. Instead of 1/2 times n, we have 1/2 plus epsilon times n. That proof is about 20 pages long, and that proof actually has been refused. We send it to the journals, and it was a secret, but not anymore, that at least two journals rejected to publish it. And the third one, Advances in Mathematics, published it. It is 70 pages, and it actually, I am pretty sure that they published it because one of the main editors is our close friend. So you know, I don't see any other reason why they really, it's just too long. So one really would could believe. Where is it? Why don't it worked before that? Yes. Then you do epsilon. One would think that the two things is almost the same, but no, it's completely different. The connecting lemma, the absorbing lemma, and so on, is much more complicated in the case when we don't have the extras. And the result is that because look at this. Now my left hand also is, so I have no left hand, no right hand. That's very bad. So you look at the why is it tight? Take two sets A and B, both of them are of size n over 2, and then the edges are so one point. That is usually 2 points from B, 1 point from A, and then every 3 points in A will form an edge, and then there will be an extra W, so that we have that kind of edges. Then take this point and take every pair here, and then these three will form an edge. And then I will not prove you that in this you can have only a Hamiltonian, a pass, but not a Hamiltonian cycle. If we had two such a point like this W1 and W2, then we would have the Hamiltonian cycle, and then you can check easily, then the edge condition is satisfied. Take this edge. Then this edge, all these points, yes, will form take this pair, then this point, then all of them will form an edge, which is n over 2, so the condition is satisfied. So actually, this is the only counterexample. This is the only example. If your graph doesn't look like this, then you don't need this n over 2, usually. Okay, the next one. Now, this is what actually is a little bit deviation from the original subject, but I will tell you because I consider that the very end after the third slide, I can formulate a conjecture. It's not my conjecture, I just consider it one of the most important problem in extremal graph theory. Maybe you agree or not, maybe you already have some proof. No, this is... Okay, then, yes. So, I don't understand. Okay. So we have now a three uniform hypergraph. Of course, we can formulate later K uniform hypergraph. And for X now, this is correct. And N star X is the neighborhood, namely that all the pairs U, W, so that X, U, W is an edge. And then this is the neighborhood of X, and so every point has a neighborhood, and then delta to X is the minimum of these neighborhoods. Actually, that is what started the graph theory, extremal graph theory, the one factor, yes? In the graph, if every degree is at least n over 2, then we have a one factor. And the next big step for Dirac theorem, then if every point has a degree n over 2, then you have a Hamiltonian cycle. That was most probably after the Turan's theorem, the first strong theorem in graph theory. Now here, but unfortunately, as far as I know, nobody investigated up to now this question. This is exactly the same thing. If H was a usual graph, then of course here we wouldn't have a pair, but only one U. Yes, and the neighborhood is the usual neighborhood. And okay. But this is a generalization of the... I don't understand. It sometimes works, it sometimes doesn't work. It works now. Okay. So, delta to star x is the minimum, the smallest neighborhood. And then the important question, good bound for delta k star h, such that h contains a one factor, not even Hamilton cycle. And of course, a much harder question would be a Hamilton cycle. And then the conjecture most probably should be that this two number, two threshold is the same. And that is a very natural task. It's natural. We started the whole extramar graph theory with one factor, yes? A condition for one factor. This is exactly the same thing. Condition for one factor. Yes, condition for one factor. Now, the next one. For instance, if we have a three-uniform hypergraph, then this shows, now then, the conjecture was that delta 2 star h bigger than 5 over 9 times n square over 2, and you see, then this is tied, because if you have this graph, what you see there, yes, but a is only 1/3 times n minus 1, and b is 2/3 times n, and there are only edges, so that at least one point of the edge, and edges, edge consists of 3 points, is in a. Now, do you have a one factor in this graph? Let's assume then 3 divides n. You cannot, because every edge contains one point in A, and in A there are only 1/3 times n minus 1. So there it doesn't contain a one factor. And nevertheless, the total, the minimum degree you can see, it's almost 5 over 9 times n square over 2. Exactly, minus 1 maybe. So we lost 1. Okay. All right. Now let's go to the next page. Then Hahn, Persson, Schacht proved that there is a one factor if we add a little bit to the 5-9, namely 5 over 9 plus epsilon. This is a pretty good result. Yes, we are almost done, right? Except there is an epsilon. And that helps a lot. And then later, Kuhn, Ostrus, Treglov, and independently my student Kahn proved that if delta chi log h is bigger than 5 over 9 times n square over 2, then h contains a one factor. Next page. Now, what about the four uniform hypergraphs? For the four uniform hypergraphs, of course, the neighborhood of the vertex are not triplets, three points at u, v, w, so that this form an edge. X, u, v, w form an edge of h. The same definition as for three, except now we are talking about four uniform hypergraph. Now, that is again the same notion, the minimum of this neighborhood denoted by delta 3, you see, because 4 uniform, it's always the index here is 1 less. Delta 3 star h. And then Kahn proved that if this is very strange number here, 37 over 64, choose n minus 1 over 3, then h contains a 1 factor. And his result is tied, exactly the same example shows, that 1/4 times n minus 1 here, and then, of course, 3/4 times n plus 1. And every 4 tuples have the, every edge has the property, then at least one point is in A. And you can check, then there is, of course, no one factor. Exactly the same idea. Now, and that is actually what I really wanted to talk about. Everything else is just an addition to it, just to talk about 55 minutes. But this is an important conjecture. I will slow down a little bit. So we are going to formulate a general conjecture. Again, let me emphasize, this is not my conjecture. This is simply, I guess, than everybody else's conjecture. Whoever worked on this kind of subject must have come to this conjecture, because this is a generalization of the first step in extramar graph theory. Then what is the minimal degree condition so that we have a one factor? So again, no, that is bad. The big conjecture I wanted. So you see, Well, why doesn't? Sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't work. No, it works now. So again, the same definition. The neighborhood of X is all the x1, x2, and so on, xk minus 1 tuples, so that x1 and all the k minus tuple together are the edges of H. And then this is the minimum, and the general conjecture is then the following. If this minimum delta k minus 1 star H is bigger than 1, it's very hard to remember, minus k minus 1 over k to the k minus 1 power, to multiply by n minus 1, choose k minus 1. For instance, if k is equal to 2, then we get back the first is at 5 ninths. You can check that this is 5 ninths. And then as this is n squared over 2. But, and also for k equal to 4, if you check this number, this will be 37 over 64. So that is why it was 37 over 54. This formula explains it. And then actually for a minute I stop here, so that please, if somebody is interested in this, try to work on it, because it is extremely important. Would be actually, it's a little bit shameful, then we as a graph theorist have really, until the last 2 or 3 years, haven't worked on that question, because this is the absolutely natural question, and this is just the generalization, as I already said, of the one-factor problem for the graph. Okay, one factor. Very natural to look for a one factor. Okay. For the general case, the best result is 2 to Glebov, Persson, and Webbs. They prove that, and you can see that this is a very, very, this I cannot even read, 1286, so it is 1286 to the k minus 1 power multiplied by 22, and this is n minus 1 choose k minus 1. Always here it is n minus 1 choose k minus 1. But of course we want 1 minus k minus 1 over k to the k minus 1. Of course, much smaller. This is almost 1, yes? If you have almost all the edges, then of course you have whatever you want. But at least they separated it from 1, yes? So we don't have all the edges. That many edges are missing. Of course, this is much, 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 much less than k minus 1 over k to the k minus 1. But anyway, this is a very reasonable result, and they prove it not only for one factor, but using the connecting lemma, they use it for Hamiltonian cycle. For 3, the situation is slightly better. Rudchinsky proved that if it is bigger than 11 over 12 plus epsilon times n squared over 2, n squared over 2 of course is n choose 2, but we don't care about minus 1 or plus 1, then it contains a Hamiltonian cycle. But you see, the result should be 5 over 9, and 11 over 12 is much bigger number than 5 over 9. For senior for hardware, yes, is true, then, well, the question now, whether 5, 9, which has been proved that if the minimum degree is 5, 9, then choose 2, then there is a one factor. That has been proved by different authors. But is it true that H contains Hamiltonian cycle? And then with Rudchinsky shocked, work in some progress, some is very not very well defined. We believe that we can finish the whole thing using the connecting lemma and the absorbing method. Actually, I'm not talking about the absorbing method, but I do believe that the absorbing method is even more important than the connecting lemma. Many paper actually about you heard about Peter Kivas, the great mathematician's result about the design. Yes, then there is a design, and actually the one of the main rule was then using the absorbing method, the semi-random method and the absorbing method. Okay, now the next slide. Now, How much more time do I have? Because I have no clock.
24 minutes.
I still have 24 minutes? Too bad. Now I have to slow down because, I actually, you can see that I easily can slow down because I just make mistake with these things and I jump through and back. So that is not a big deal. So what is a, now I start with the connecting lemma. But I will formulate the simplest connecting lemma for graph. Actually, this is much more powerful for hypergraphs, or if you want case power of usual graph, but we actually will work only for three. So the square of, for Pósa, the square of Hamilton and cycle. So the connecting lemma. Unfortunately, we need some definition. The first is eligible vertices. We call a vertex V an eligible if for every L in that interval. Don't pay too much attention on these numbers. These numbers are not really computed correctly. What I mean is, then this whole thing is in preparation, so this is just to be on the safe side. Every number will be much smaller, but this one is enough. So a vertex is eligible if, for every L in that interval, the number of passes of lengths L between any two vertices of the neighborhood of V is at least eta to the, eta is a small number, to the 4 times L. Again, don't remember, it's just, then this is a eta is fixed, so this is a positive percentage. Eta to the 4 times L times N to the L. Well, if we have a pass of L plus 2 vertices and the 2 endpoints are fixed, then how many passes we can have? At most N to the L, but this is a gross upper bound. Yes, we cannot have, but actually the magnitude is N to the L. Well, because every time we have N different choices and then connecting V1 and V2. So, but it is, you see, it is a very good property being eligible. Then for every pair, you have a positive percentage all the passes connecting V1 and V2. And so then we have a, what you have to remember, then we have positive percentage of them. And then what these numbers also are irrelevant, then altogether this would be the maximum number of passes between 2 points because we are in the neighborhood of NV and this is only of size 2/3 times N, so it's. And what is important, then in double counting, it is easy to see that in G, there are at least N over K squared, so no powers, N over K squared eligible vertices. I'm not going to prove, this is just Fubini. You count vice and versa, so you, it's a double counting. So the next page, another definition. A pass of lengths L is good if it is in pass of length is in NV for at least that many vertices. Now we don't again A to the K, A to the K, A to the K, but this number actually should be eta to the K. But again, just being on the safe side because again, double counting, which we just don't care about the numbers yet. So again, a pass of length L is good if it is in many there are many vertices so that the pass is in their neighborhood. And the number of vertices, all what you have to remember is proportional to N. Yes, altogether we have N vertices, so then the number of vertices is proportional, but the proportion is very small, A to the K, to the K, to the K, but again, it can be reduced drastically. Well, if it's not good, then it is bad. We call a vertex V good. We call the pass good. Now we call the vertex good if NV contains at most that many, at most. So the number of bad passes is small. This number, what you see here, is much smaller than this number, what you see there. But, well, it is not so clear because I am sure that neither you or me, nor me can read this number. But if I am sure that it's 100 times k squared to the 4 to the k to the eta to the k to the k to the k times 10 to the l, so this is much smaller than this one because there is this eta. Don't worry. So in NV contains at most, so a vertex V, of course, when the vertex V is good. If it contains a lot of good passes, the number of bad passes is small. And small simply, again, means this. Okay. But for every L between this interval, an easy calculation shows that the number of good vertices is big, n times 1 minus 1 over 100 times k squared, but is important, then this is polynomial. And the number of vertices which are both eligible and good, these are the real good vertices, is that, well, almost the same, but we have to divide it by 4 times k, n over 4 times k times 1 minus 1 over 100 times k squared. So now with this definition, maybe we can formulate the connecting lemma, and which we call lemma 1. The connecting lemma is the following. Given a clique, actually, you can... what happened? Again, this is playing a game with me. This obviously, I am not an expert. Before it worked, where is it now? Oh, it's here, yes. So I have no practice. Actually, maybe it is third or fourth time that I use computer, and I need at least 4 or 5 times to hit the object, yes? Actually, I have to tell you that there is nothing strange about it. I have 3 keys, and then when I want to open my office, then actually, I made a statistics and guess. So how many times I had to try, how many keys I used trying to open the office. Actually, the average was 3.6, which is obviously explains why I'm making so many mistakes here, because where it is again a mistake. Because can you imagine then, well, the person who has never visited a university, most probably the average wouldn't be more than 3. Yes, you check the first key, the second key, and then the remaining third. So actually not only the average, the maximum shouldn't be more than 3, but then my good friend Komlos told me that the right way to do it, then every my key has a different color. So I just had to remember then which color opens which office. So now my average actually is 1. It's a big improvement. So like here, you can have an improvement over everything, except still I cannot get this properly. Though I use my left hand, never will I will use computer again. Why doesn't... Everybody could do this, except me. Actually, my 2 years, I am pretty sure my 2 years granddaughter would perform better than me, but we will check. Next time I will bring and then we will check it. Why cannot I do this? This is really embarrassing. Maybe intentionally you give me the wrong, why? Because I don't know then where it points to. Okay, so given a clique, A1, A2, AK minus 1, and BK minus 1, BK minus 1 to B1, just in a different order I wrote, then there is an L which is not too big, such that we can connect these 2 cliques with at least that many times. So how many, if the length is L, then of course then the number of connecting passes can be at least and at most n to the l, yes? Because if the length is l, then n to the l. Now we lose a little bit, again, this strange number is here. So the conjecture lemma says then taking any two complete k minus 1, so a1, a2, and so ak minus form a complete graph, also bk minus 1 form a complete graph, then there is an L, so that the number of passes connecting these two, so that it will be a k minus 1 pass, which we are after. I eventually want a k minus 1 Hamiltonian cycle, then at least that many passes we can have. And even if we forbid, and that is very important, then the enemy says that we cannot use that little n vertices in the connection, so they cannot be on the line. Still, we can have a lot of line, actually positive percentage of all possible lines. No, sorry. Let me see, 18, yes, I was here. So, definition, then what is a graph, when the graph is extremal, if the graph is extremal, now if I cannot hit, now I can hit now, because I will start from here and just go to the right. So if the size of A is between 1 over k minus epsilon times n and 1 over k plus epsilon times n, then the density is small, then we say that our graph, if there exists such an A, then our graph is extremal graph, and then it is not hard to solve the problem in the extremal case. So now we forget about the extremal graph. Now if G is not extremal, then there are that many vertices in our graph such that V is good and eligible. And that is very important for every V in this set. There is a set TV for which the size is big, and then for every element, N TIV intersection, the complement of NV is less than N over K minus some gain, square root theta times N. Don't forget, it could be n over k, yes? Because actually every edge goes outside of the neighborhood of V. But no, there is a V, so that there is a big set, then the degree to the complement is slightly less than the maximum n over k. That is what we have to remember. And then we know this set of these Vs, which are good by M. So now we fix a vertex in M, which has this nice property, and we denote, for simplicity, we denote the neighborhood by F, and then now we formulate the lemma 3, and then we can start with the conjecture lemma, which is called the extending lemma, and the extending lemma says the following. Given a click, I know what to do. Start to the right, left, and then go to the right. So given a click of k minus 1 vertices, one can extend it with vertices w1, w2, ws, s less than k minus 1, maybe 0, and x1 extends on xk minus 1, such that this is a k minus 1 pass, a1, a2, ak minus 1, v1, v2, vs, x1, x2n, so next k minus 1, is a k minus 1 pass. And what is very important, and the last k minus 1 element is in the neighborhood of the V. It is in F, but F is the, we denote is the neighborhood of V. Moreover, the number of the sets, the number of these good extensions is at least how many elements it has, k minus 1, yes, plus s, that many, yes. And then we only lose alpha over 10 percentage of alpha over 10 to the k minus 1 plus s percentage of all possible connections, yes, of possible passes, because if you have that many elements, then n to the k minus 1 plus s is the number, the maximum number of all possible passes. So this is the extending lemma. Actually, the extending lemma is needed to get into a good set. And now, connecting a1, a2, ak minus 1, and here comes actually the essence of the whole connecting lemma. The previous things actually quite technical, but this is the real connecting lemma. What we do? So we want a1, a2, ak minus 1. Try again. Yes, good. Actually, if you give me 15 more minutes, or 10 minutes, I really will learn it. I promise. Okay, so then a1, a10, and so on. So what v? Yeah, v is one of these which are in M, and then you know there was this TV, which they have the nice property. Then to the complement, they were not full degree. So first we choose k elements in TV. What are these elements? These elements doesn't have a full degree to the complement of NV. And then, of course, then this easy you can check. Then if take any of this, that it should be ZI, then you can extend it UK minus 1 I, UK minus 2. So altogether, how many elements you have here? K, if it starts with 2, k minus 1, so k minus 2 elements. And then on the right-hand side, also k minus 2 elements. And you can check easy, it's an exercise. Then if you take any z, then you easily can choose this use. So that this whole thing is a k minus 1 pass. Because zi had no full degree outside the neighborhood of v, of course. It's not very... And of course, these passes will be vertex disjoint. The extending lemma will be applied to a1, a2, ak minus 1, and also to bk minus 1, bk minus 1, b1. So we consider the k minus 1 passes, a1, a2, and so on, ak minus 1. You remember this was the extending lemma. Then this exists. And from the other side, this exists too, yes? So from the right, maybe this will be a picture eventually. Yes, it's a picture. So, my last try. No. I would have to be very careful. Start from the left. What happened? It's ridiculous. Yes. So you see a1, a2, and so on, and then up to here it ends with xk minus 1, and then these are the z1s, and the u's are around them. The u's are around them. The u's are around them, and so on and so on. And then b1, b2, bk minus 1, and now. So what we want actually between, so we want actually connect this whole thing so that it will be only a k minus 2 pass. That is the whole essence of the thing. Then we require only k minus 2 pass. And you will see then automatically we can get a k minus 1 pass. So how? So. They are k minus, so using the induction hypothesis, we can connect we can connect xk minus 1 to the first z1, uk minus 1, 1, uk minus 2, 1, and so uk, u, 2, 1, and then z1. And then we can connect it with x2, xk minus 1 inside of the neighborhood of V. That actually k minus 2 pass, and then inside NV, how big is NV? K minus 2 over k at least, but the relative density is k minus 2 minus k minus 1. So therefore, we can use the induction hypothesis, and then we can connect them. And also we know then how many ways, and then what are the lengths. And then we connect U. That is... I was here, yes, or even not here. Yes, I was here. Then, of course, then we continue. We connect this one, the second one, to the first. So we connect in general uk plus 2i, un, so uk plus 2i, to the, what is the length of the connection? Okay, we now connect to the, so we connect the tail of this z. Z has a beginning and the tail, and we collect the tail to the beginning of the next z. Of course, before the z, we have this uk minus 1i, and so uk minus 1 u to i. So we can connect this, and then we connect the i's ending segment to the I plus 1 initial segment, yes? So that is very natural. So we start from here, and then if we have the i's, tail, then we can connect it to the initial segment of the I plus 1 z, because of, again, the inductive hypothesis. And then we then had, at the very end, we connect to the yk minus 1, and then, in this case, we have a k minus 2 pass. But this is only k minus 1 2 pass, and then, on the next, we will finish. And even if we delete the z's, any z, still it is, you can check, it is still a k minus 2 pass. And even after removing any number of z's. Now, let the number of vertices on the path from xk minus 1 to yk minus 1 be, now again, well, that's much better, k minus 1 times t plus r, where r is, of course, less than k minus 1 because we divide by k minus 1. We omit r vertices z1, z2, zr, so if we omit that many vertices, that what is the length of our path? K minus 1 times t, yes? So actually, k minus 1 divides the length of the path. So then, so, and also, you don't have to read it, it just means that we have the total number of passes is as much as we need. If the length of the path is gamma, then we have this, forget, this is positive percentage, but very small. Then n to the gamma should be the total number of passes between two points of length gamma. And we get it, that many. The small, again, double counting shows it. But what is the situation now? We have a pass which the lengths can be divided by k minus 1, but unfortunately, the path is of k minus 2 power. But what we do? But we know about the path, because there are that many, then most of them are good passes, so above them there is very many points, so that they contain a given path p. So take a path, which is a good path, and also so take a path p joining x1 and y1, and for this p, tp is all the v's, so that the neighborhood of p contains v is eligible, and the neighborhood of p is namely the v's, so that the path is in its neighborhood is big. Tp is positive percentage of n. So then we shall change this p, our path, into k minus path. How? Now that is straightforward. By inserting t vertices from tp. How? We insert the insert the following way. We move along p, starting with yk minus 1, so the next point will be from tp. But actually, because the whole pass is in the neighborhood, so therefore then this point is connected with everybody. So therefore, at the beginning, at least we have already a k minus 1 path. Now we move to the next, move from right to left, but we just make t minus 1 steps, k minus 1 steps, and again we insert a point and another point. You see, tp is big. We insert another point. We have it because we only have to have a small number because the whole length of the path is bounded by k. So we insert a point, and then because the whole path is in the neighborhood, we can insert the point and make the whole thing up to here, a k minus 1 path. And you do it again, and at the next k minus, after the next k minus 1, you put one point from TP and so on until you arrive to xk minus 1. And why we needed this divisibility property? Because if you really meditate a little bit, if we stop before xk minus 1, then we cannot say that the resulting configuration from x1, x10, and xk minus 1, and so on, is k minus 1 path. But if next to xk minus 1 there is a point from tp, then the whole thing is a k minus 1 path to the left. So therefore, we inserted all these points, and that is actually the essence of the whole connecting lemma. Then you somehow, with all this computation, arrive to the case when you can go down by one dimension. What does that mean? Then we here only had k minus 2 passes. Yes, it was enough to build k minus 2 passes, and almost automatically from there we got the k minus 1 passes. And then practically, if you really go with the induction down, then you have to say something only about a graph, regardless what is your k. And the same applies for the hypergraph. Then you always, if you start with k uniform hypergraphs, then you can play back to k minus 1 uniform hypergraphs and so on, and at the very end you go back to the graph, and we know much more about the graph than for the hypergraphs. So this inductive steps or going from up to down actually makes it possible to deal only with graph, nothing else. Only whether in your resulting graph, the graph is connected. And once it is connected, then you are done. So that is the essence of this thing, that you really gain dimensions. So regardless what k you give me, then I can go back to the graph. And I am just have to connect two points in the graph, of course, in many ways. And therefore, this is connecting is powerful, because we have to deal only with graph. So therefore, it's actually, there are 3 or 4 or 5 papers now which uses this thing, but it is just the start. Okay, sorry for this clumsy presentation, and especially, I am not sorry for this, because it is better than my usual performance to use this PowerPoint. I don't understand. Actually, I have to admit that I have never taken a picture in my whole life, so it is not so surprising that I cannot use the computer. But if you invite me again, maybe in 10 years, then I promise you that even if I will be blind, I will do it absolutely automatically. Thank you very much, and sorry again for the...
We are a little bit late, but maybe you have one question.
I can have one question. Which Why one? Didn't you stop me? But you told me 24 minutes.
For random graph, the threshold for Hamiltonicity is log n over n. Is the known threshold for kth power in random graphs?
Well, maybe with different constants, yes, it should be. Should
but the
be.
Same order.
Yes. It shouldn't be any different because, yes, in random graph, the edges actually really are connected in a nice way.
And this is written up somewhere? Or?
No. Nobody looked at it. It is just because you ask something, I have to answer something. but please check it. The bet would be then it would be the same, but with a much smaller, bigger constant, still some constant times again over n. If it was not the case, it was would be surprise. Because you see everywhere the one factor, and for the one factor, yes, then you have complete k minus one. And the Hamiltonian cycle is the same. At least up to now, there is no counterexample, then the two things differ. I mean, the two thresholds differ. That is a very surprising fact, yes, because the connecting k power of a Hamiltonian cycle is a much more complex, not very complex, but much more complex structure than just one factor. Nevertheless, the threshold is the same, at least up to now, because we cannot prove the big question what I asked, even for one factor, whether it is the same. So, of course, then we cannot say anything about the Hamiltonian cycle. Thank you for the question. Yeah.
Okay, thank you once again. I think let's thank the speaker.